Well, good morning and welcome to Living Waters Fellowship, our Sunday morning online worship service. And as always, before we get started and before we move forward, we need to take this time and ask the Lord God to bless our time together, along with bringing His healing touch upon us physically, emotionally, spiritually, especially spiritually, because we need to seek His purpose and plan for our lives. And so would you bow your heads as we ask the Lord? Heavenly Father, we come today humbly asking for Your presence in our time together, because we know and believe, Lord God, that You are here in our midst. And Lord, I would also like to ask if You would come in power and that Your presence would be manifested as we boldly come before Your throne of grace to receive Your grace and mercy in our time of need. And so, Lord, I ask that You would do a great work in our time together as we run this race that You have set before us. Bring us Your healing touch. Bring Your healing touch upon our hearts and give us the courage that we're going to need. Open our ears to hear what You, Holy Spirit, are speaking this morning. And this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, please take this moment as we now enter into our time of worship, and let's bring to the Lord God our worship with the whole of our hearts. You know, because He is worthy of our worship. He is worthy of our praise. The Bible says that we are to worship the Lord God in spirit and in truth. Don't just fast forward. Don't just put it on, turn up the volume and go get something to eat from the refrigerator, okay? I know that's what you do. Let's be honest here. Take this time and let's just worship the Lord together.
Turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like You, none like You. Into the darkness You shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no myself in light. In darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice. It trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. Age to age stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end, yeah. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me.
Come on.
And I'm desperate for you. desperate for you. This is the This is the air I breathe.
Your holy presence.
Your holy presence.
Yes, Lord.
Living in me. This is my day.
Oh, you're my.
Good morning and welcome to Living Waters Fellowship. We are a spiritual oasis in the middle of the desert, a place where God's healing waters flow. Our church is based on three pillars: evangelism, each one reach one, discipleship, building up the house of God in every person, and our mission is to make a difference in our community for Christ. We do have a biblical maxim that we repeat if you will join me. We are mighty men and women of valor because we are greater in the eyes of God than we are in our own eyes. And while our hearts may condemn us, God is greater than our hearts, and he knows what truly lies within. And that's taken from Judges 6 and 1 John 3. I would like to remind you, if you would like to continue to send your tithes during this time of quarantine, you can send them in. Our physical address is 211 West 1st South, Suite C, Mesquite, 89027. We have a box number, 3294. That zip code is 89127. Or please go to our church's webpage at mesquitelivingwaters.com. Wednesday night is our men and women's Bible study. And this week, the men and women will join in an in-depth study through the book of Daniel. And it is a great study for the times we are going through now. It is primarily a video series by Beth Moore, but Pastor Dennis will be teaching it through the chapters as well. If you would like to order a book, a study book to go along with it, please let the church know. They are $16. You can also order your own through Lifeway or Christian Book. Unfortunately, the women's retreat that we were going to have in October is going to be canceled due to the restrictions placed upon the group size, and the speaker, who is coming from Canada, would be in quarantine for a total of 4 weeks, 2 in the U.S. and 2 when she returns. So please continue to pray about that we will be able to reschedule it at another time. Pastor Mike is continuing his series on Sunday nights at 6 o'clock, End Times and Current Events. The message this week will be Destruction of the Temple and the Sign of the Times, and you can also see that through our YouTube channels. Pastor Dennis's Wednesday Word is going to be titled The Rapture. He will be looking at various doctrines of the Bible, and he is going to be starting by looking at the doctrines surrounding the end times. So please, go to our website and the YouTube channel and see these messages for yourself. Please, will you take a moment and join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you that through so many new things, we can get the word out, Father, for people that are members of our church and people that are not members of our church, as we strive so hard to share your word, to be a witness for you, Father, and do what you will have us do in whatever capacity we can. We just ask that you mightily bless our endeavors, bless Pastor Dennis as he shares his word with us today. Amen.
And so, Lord God, we ask that today you would anoint our minds, Lord God, you would anoint our hearts through your Holy Spirit as we continue in our worship of you. Would you open up your word to our hearts? Would you open up your word to our minds so that we can receive your message, Lord God, for our lives and for the church? I would also ask, Lord, that you, Holy Spirit, would heal what we have so badly broken and bruised, not only in our bodies, but in our souls and in our spirits. And this, again, as always, we ask the name of our Savior and Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, as always, we like to begin our time together in a song, but it's not just a song, it's a prayer, asking the Holy Spirit to come and to fill us and to anoint us so that we can hear what it is that He is speaking. And so would you join with me, please? Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Melt me, mold me, fill me, use me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Holy Spirit, I ask that you would do that you would anoint us afresh this morning. Pour that fresh anointing oil over us, Lord God, renewing our minds, renewing our hearts, renewing our souls and our spirits. We ask this in Jesus' name, because, Lord Jesus, you say if we ask anything in your name, that our Heavenly Father would do it. So that is why we ask in your name. Amen. Well, today we're continuing in our series on practical faith, and I'd like to talk to you about today about running God's race. But before I do, let me ask some critical questions. What have you felt like giving up on? Is it your dream, your goals, your marriage? Do you feel like giving up on God? Or do you just feel like giving up, period? And then, what have you left undone? Is it a commitment, a project, a promise, a vow, a pledge? And then finally, what is holding you back? What is distracting you? Is it a relationship, or is it fear or worry, job or possessions, or is it possibly misplaced values and morals? These are critical questions that need to be answered when we consider what the writer of Hebrews says in Hebrews 12, verse 1. He said, "Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us." You see, the Bible describes life like a race, not a 100-yard dash, mind you, but a marathon. And while everybody runs this race, everybody runs the same race, the idea here is that not everyone is going to finish this race well. They'll get discouraged, distracted, hurt, or they'll just simply give up. Eventually, they're going to find themselves sitting on the sidelines with their dreams unrealized, and then giving up on God, and then their God-given potential. They leave a lot of life unfinished. They start off well, but soon they get tired, bored, distracted. They never finish, and life feels unfulfilled for them. They've strewn the rubble of uncompleted projects, unfulfilled commitments, unrealized promises throughout the course of their life. They're literally sitting on the side of the road over here. All these things are sitting on the side of the road behind them. The Apostle Paul talks about this life as a race, saying this, that if we want to receive the prize of heaven at the end, we need to run this race. We need to live this life then according to the rules. In other words, if you are a track and you're running track, you have to run between the lines. And that's what he's talking about. We have to learn how to run between the lines, because if you get outside the lines, you may finish the race, but they're never going to record it for you. But people still live this life saying stuff like, well, life happens. Well, yeah, life does happen. But what's also true is life is what we make of it. Our character is not determined by how well we start the race. Rather, our character is determined by how we finish it. That's why Paul could say, "I have fought the good fight. I've finished the race. I have kept the faith. Finally, there's laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, our righteous judge, will give to me on that day. And not to me only, but also to all those who love his appearing." And so today we're going to be looking at how we are to run this race and how we are to finish this race, this life of faith, even when we feel like giving up. We'll be looking at four things everyone needs to do if they want to finish this race well. And at the end of the race, hear the Lord say to them, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord." And so the first thing that we need to do, we need to remove the hindrances. We need to remove those things that are dragging us down and holding us back from being everything that God has called us to be. And we see that in the first part of what we just talked about in Romans 12, verse 1. It says, "Let us lay aside every weight and the sin that so easily ensnares us." By using the word weight and sin side by side, what he is saying is that there are some things that we do in this life that may not be sin, but they also may not be the best thing for us or for those others that we know and love. And now the word laying aside, well, that word in the Hebrew language and in the Greek language basically means the same thing. It doesn't mean by taking your shirt, taking it off, putting it on a hanger and hanging it up nice, or folding your t-shirts. No, what it means is a violent taking off and throwing it away or throwing it from us. Think of it this way. If you're water skiing, but you're not wearing a bathing suit, but you're wearing a snowsuit, and you fall off that ski, I guarantee you that you're going to be tearing off that snowsuit as fast as you can before you sink to the bottom of the lake. Or think of it this way. Let's say you're a runner. I have never seen an athlete run in their sweats. What they do is they take their sweats off and they strip down to the lightest weight clothing possible so they can run effectively. What we need to understand is this, is that God has made each of us uniquely. Therefore, God has created a unique race for each and every one of us to run. Our problem is the expectations that others place upon us. And that's because they want us to run their race rather than the race that God has made for us to run. We can only live this life that God has given to us. That's the only life that we have to live. And he's given it to us and us alone. We will never finish this race well if we if we don't let go of these false expectations that others have of us. If we live by any other expectation than God's expectation, then we're not giving God our best. And we're not going to finish this race, this life of faith, very well. And so the writer of Hebrews tells us that if we want to finish well, we're going to have to simplify. We need to get rid of the baggage and remove all these diversions and eliminate all these distractions, whatever else weighs us down, that prevents us from running God's race, the race that God has set before us. Now, one of the main distractions is all the stuff we acquire, and that is our possessions. As I thought about that, I thought about a movie by Jim Henson of Muppet fame. And the movie was called Labyrinth. Now, in that movie, there was a teenage girl, and she resented the fact that she had to watch her baby brother. Well, this guy comes, the Goblin King comes, and he steals her baby brother. And so she has to go into his kingdom to try to rescue him. And the show's all about that. Well, in one scene, she is found back in her room again. But there's an old Muppet lady there with her. And she's got all this stuff on, this Muppet lady has all this stuff on her back. So what she starts doing is in this young girl's room is all of her prized possessions. And so she starts putting all these possessions of this young girl on her back and keeps putting them on her back. And the more of these possessions she puts on their back, the more this young girl forgets her goal and forgets her mission. And that's what happens to us. We start worrying about keeping and holding on to all the stuff, and in the process, we lose our way. We become so distracted by the stuff that we'll soon find ourselves out of the game and on the sidelines. Another hindrance is our past. Now, we are to remember our past, as we talked about last week, but what I'm talking about is focusing on our past, because our past weighs us down. And that's because we're either loaded down with guilt and shame over what we have done, or we're loaded down with bitterness and resentment over what somebody else has done to us. Now, consider the Apostle Paul. He had a past that haunted him, that could have crippled him and dragged him down to the bottom of that lake, like that snowsuit when the person was water skiing. That was Paul and what he did. That could have dragged him to the bottom. But just as bad was the church's treatment of Paul, as it shunned him once he became a believer. And so Paul had a choice. He could either focus on the guilt and shame over what he did, or he'd become resentful and bitter over the church's treatment of him. But instead, he made another choice. And that's what he talks about. He said, "One thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus." Paul is saying is that he wasn't going to allow the things of the past to drag him down any longer. He had to run a race, and he wasn't going to focus any longer on what lays behind, but rather he was going to focus on the finish line. Through the prophet Isaiah, the Lord said this, "Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I'm doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I'm making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland." God has got a special race for each one of us to run. And he has something special for each one of us to do. And so we've got to stop dwelling on the past so we can do what God has called us to do and to move forward into that goal, into those plans and purposes that he has for our lives. And so the first thing we need to do is remove everything that is hindering our progress and distracting us from moving forward. The second thing is we have to remember the reward. We cannot run this race well unless we have our eyes fixed on the finish line. If we're going to finish this life well, then we have to continue to remind ourselves what's at the finish line and why we're even doing what we're doing, what God has called us to do. We have to remind ourselves, why are we doing it? And the why determines so much, because if the why is attached to short-term goals, then we'll stop before we get to the end. But if that why is attached to long-term goals, that is, eternal goals, then we'll last until the end. You see, gratification won't see us to the end. It never sees us to the end. But when our goal is God's eternal rewards, that is when we're going to run this race well. And that is when we're going to finish well. And so when we finish, if you feel like giving up, let's focus on the finish instead of focusing on the past. Look at how Paul sees it. He said, to win the contest, you must deny yourself many things that would keep you from doing your best. We do it for a heavenly reward that never disappears. So I run straight to the goal with the purpose in every step. A heavenly reward, personally rewarded by God. Now, some people wonder if there's any heavenly reward at all. The problem is their idea that God bases his rewards, or God's rewards are based upon which side of the scale of judgment we're sitting upon. On the one side is all the good stuff we do. On the other side is all the bad stuff we do. And so what we hope is that by the end, all the good stuff is going to outweigh the bad stuff. Fortunately, God doesn't reward us based upon such a scale. Instead, he rewards us based upon his grace. All the sins we have committed, God forgives based upon his grace through faith in Jesus Christ. What grace means is that every good thing we do is by faith. Every word we speak is by faith. Every thought that we think is by faith. That is what God rewards. The idea of eternal rewards, however, is foreign to most people, because when things get difficult, we sit in front of the TV or in front of the internet. We look forward to the weekend, or we count the days to our next vacation. But unfortunately, with most of the hotels shut down, you know, there is no vacation. But no weekend or vacation, let me just say that, is ever going to be good enough, and it's never going to be long enough, trust me. That's why we need to remember that we have an eternity waiting for us in heaven. That's where our focus needs to be. The third thing we need to do is we need to resist discouragement. Discouragement comes easy when all we think about is our health or our finances, our marriage, job, children, or what's going on today with this COVID-19. And while discouragement is a reality of life, it's also a choice we make. We choose whether or not we are going to be discouraged and remain discouraged. The Bible says it this way: as a person thinks deep within their heart, that is who they're eventually going to become. D.L. Moody said it this way: I have never known God to use a discouraged person. You see, discouragement is the opposite of faith, because it looks at problems through human understanding rather than looking at the problems through the eyes of God and through the eyes of faith. Look at how the Apostle Paul approached discouragement. He said, and let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. One reason we get tired of doing what is right is because doing what is wrong is so much easier. I mean, it's easier to tell a lie than it is a truth. It's easier to do what is wrong. It's easier to be selfish than to be unselfish. So why should we resist the urge and not get tired of doing what is right? I think it's found in the phrase, in due season. In other words, after a while, we'll reap a harvest if we don't quit. Think of it like a newly planted seed of corn. When you plant a seed of corn, you're not going to harvest a seed back. You're going to harvest hundreds of seeds back. Because that one seed goes into a stalk, and on that stalk, maybe 10, 15, 20 cobs of corn. And each cob has possibly even 60 to 100 little corn cobby things on it. I don't know what they call it, but I have all these corn seeds on it. And see, that's God's kingdom. That's his kingdom. You know, it's his economy. And so when we plant that one seed, well, it's that seed of faith, we can expect a whole lot more back as a result. And while we might not see immediate results, let me just say this, the results are coming if we are faithful. But that begs the question, why does God delay? I think the reason is because God is letting our faith grow and mature. Our problem is that we live in a society that's a society of instant gratification. It's like we decide on God's principle to give the tithe. And so we give the tithe. But all of a sudden, and we give the tithe according to God's word, but all of a sudden, well, we don't see immediate results. We think that by next week we should have all these results because we tithe this week. That doesn't work like that. But by faith, when we wait, God will open up those windows of heaven and pour out a blessing upon us. Our key here is that those blessings may not be money or anything like that. Those blessings may very well just be a renewal of your marriage. Maybe it's a new job, whatever it may be, but that's God's blessing because God will open up those windows of heaven. Anything that's worth doing is worth the time and investment we put into it. Michelangelo did not create the statue David in a day. He didn't take one swing of the hammer and then all of a sudden there you have the statue of David. That statue took 3 years and he picked off a little piece at a time. It's a long process that we need to look at. Because to make a masterpiece takes a while. And that's including us because we are God's masterpiece. And so God's going to take a while to create us into that masterpiece that he has destined for us to be. But to help fight discouragement, let me give you three things to remember. Three things. First, remember God's goodness. Remember all those times God has bailed us out. You remember those times when God has bailed you out? Met our need, answered a prayer, brought joy and peace to our troubled hearts. You remember those times? We have to remember God's goodness. We have to remember God's presence. Remember that no matter what, that God is always with us, that he'll never leave us nor forsake us. And while we may not feel God's presence in our midst, what we do know is that he is always there. So we have to remember God's presence. And finally, remember God's promises. Remember his promises, especially the greatest promise of them all. And that is when we come to belief in Jesus Christ, there awaits for us heaven and all eternity in the presence of the Lord. So the key to defeating discouragement is to change our focus. Change our focus off the world, off of our problems, off of ourselves, and focus in on God's goodness, God's presence, and God's promises. And so first we have to remove whatever is hindering our walk in the Lord. Next, we have to remember the rewards and not our past failures. And then we need to resist discouragement in whatever form it takes. And finally, we need to renew ourselves daily in the Lord. And that's the last one, renew ourselves daily. We have to find those ways to recharge our physical and spiritual batteries. And when I thought about that, I thought of those fighter pilots that go on those missions across the seas. But they're flying their jet planes over there. But there's no place for them to land and get fuel. And so they have to learn the art of mid-flight refueling so they can get to their mission and their goal and to succeed. Well, the same for us. We must learn the art of mid-life refueling so that we can move forward into the goals and plans and purposes of God. And so there's two aspects of this renewal. The first aspect is physical. Psalm 127 says, "It is vain for you to rise up early and to sit up late, to eat the bread of sorrows, for so he gives his beloved sleep." Vince Lombardi, the famous football coach of the Green Bay Packers, he said, "Fatigue makes cowards of us all. When we are physically tired, we become discouraged." Well, so we need both physical exercise and rest to be renewed. But yet the Bible says something else as well. It says, "For bodily exercise profits little." In other words, it does profit, but it doesn't profit a whole lot. He says, "But godliness is profitable for all things, having the promise of life that now is and that which is to come." Now the word godliness, we could say it this way, is spiritual. And so what he's saying is, while it's good to keep our physically healthy and strong, Our renewal also has to be spiritual, and that's a second renewal, spiritual renewal. In 1 Corinthians 4:16, "Therefore we do not lose heart, even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is being renewed day by day. And so the way we become spiritually renewed is by taking time every single day, taking time to be with God, taking time in God's Word, taking time in prayer. Let me just say this. Jesus never gave up, even though he saw the cross was before him. Why? Because he was thinking of us. He was looking at that finish line. And so he took our place and died the death that we all deserve so that we could have eternal life. You see, he knew of the rewards. And therefore, what the Apostle Paul says, he became obedient unto death. Didn't give up. For us, it's never too late. God is not finished with any one of us. And there's a race to be run. Now, it doesn't matter how someone starts the race. It also doesn't matter if somehow we've messed up along the way and have placed ourselves on the sideline due to discouragement. That doesn't matter. What matters is finishing well. We may have tripped. We may have fallen. We may have put ourselves on the sideline due to discouragement, but neither of those matter. It's all about right here, right now. It's about getting started. It's all about getting back into the race and finishing it. So it's my sincerest desire at the end of this life that we all can say, I have finished the race, like the Apostle Paul. I have finished the race, and I have kept the faith. And when we stand before our Heavenly Father, my sincerest desire is we hear these words, well done, good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of your Lord. Will you bow your heads with me, please? Heavenly Father, I want to thank you so much for what you have given to us and the strength and the courage that you have given to us. And Lord, that is what I'm asking now, is that you would give each and every person that strength and courage to run this race, to live this life by faith in you and in you only. And that we would run this race so well that we would finish and hear the words of you, Lord Jesus, say to us, well done, good and faithful servant, enter into the joy of your Lord. But we have to start the race. And how do we start the race? It's just not by being born physically. Rather, it's by being born spiritually. Jesus said it's by being born again, spiritually born again, born from above, having a new spiritual life which comes through belief in Jesus Christ when we accept him as our Savior and Lord. Apostle Paul said, by grace you have been saved through faith, not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone boast. And so we begin this race by accepting Jesus Christ as our Savior and Lord. And then we continue this race, running this race based upon that faith and counting upon God's grace all along the way. That's why the writer of Hebrews says that we can boldly come before his throne of grace to receive grace and mercy to help us in our time of need. And so, Lord, we come today asking for that grace and mercy. Help us to run this race well. And help us to be those examples, those shining lights of you to a world that is lost, where lives have been shattered and are left on the highway of this road of life. Lord, that we can shine that light and lift them up and bring them upon that narrow road that leads to everlasting life, that leads to heaven with you at the end. So, Lord, we give you all thanks and glory for what you have done, and more importantly, what you are going to do. As we continue to look to you, Lord Jesus, the author and the finisher, the perfecter of our faith. And this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Power in the name of Jesus. every chain, break every chain.